All right, let's get the show on the road. Hello and welcome to Accidental Origin, the weekly writing web show appearing daily for this week only. My name is Brendan. This is my show. If you are new to the channel or new to what I've been doing this week, I started a short story about 8 weeks ago, live on stream. You can check out my VODs on my website, on YouTube channel, as well as the highlights on Twitch. If you want to see that stuff, starts in episode 3. I started playing this short story. So I've kind of worked up through all the steps. I started with brainstorming, mind maps. Then I moved into log lines, outlines, character profiles, all that good stuff. And this week, since I am on vacation, I decided that I was going to draft the majority of the story. So I did that. I sat down at the beginning of the week, and every day I worked on a new scene, culminating in yesterday finishing a general first draft. So today, I thought it would be fun to do to start editing. To push this a little bit further. So that's kind of my plan. I set up my GorillaPod. I'll just go down there. I set up my GorillaPod here so that you can get a nice close-up view of what I'm doing with editing. I edit it almost exclusively on paper. I prefer it. It's much easier to read things and see things that are wrong and how they look on the page. And stuff like that. Adjust that a little bit more. Perfect. Right in frame. You don't have to do that. It's not for everyone. Though I know a lot of people who do. It's annoying if you want to send notes digitally. For sure. But what I'm going to do is, after the editing session today, I'm actually going to scan it. Using an auto document feeder. And put it up on the website as well. Along with the first draft, so you guys can kind of see my edits as I go. Hey, Bassman, what's up? So yeah, that's kind of my plan. I'm gonna work through that today. So I set up this special screen so you can see me and you can see the thing. Oh, cool, man. How many more days of shooting do you have? Not bright enough. What do we think? See the corner of my DS there. 15 days? Jesus Christ. I've never been on a shoot that long. Because you've already done like what, like 4? Maybe 5? I guess you probably started Monday, right? Yeah, let's make this a little bigger. Can't make it too big, though. Because it's gonna... Let me grab another light. See if I can make this a little better.
Test this, but I tested it with the wrong light setup. Well, I suppose that's fair. I didn't really think about that, but that makes a lot of sense that it would be a future film. Yeah. Oh yeah. Totally, man. I've been there. There was one short movie, a short film I worked on, and it took us, it took us 5 hours to shoot a 2-minute scene because one actor couldn't get the dialogue lines right, but the other one did it perfectly. He did it the exact same way every single time, and it was like amazing. So let's put that there. That being said, the guy who did it right every time was a professional actor who's had a master's degree in acting from university, and the other guy was a semi-pro who had done some films but was not like super crazy. Okay, let's try this now. Hopefully I won't completely blow out everything. Oh god. Oh no. Nope, I don't like it. I can't even see the screen properly. No. So much of that plane. So much of that plane. Oh. It looks okay. Oh my god. I've been there. I did a weekend shoot once for a short film that ended up being a 45-second film. Took us all weekend. Like, I'm talking like three 14-hour shoots. Like, it's craziness. But we were trying to get specific effects, and like, it was difficult. And, you know, we had to do a lot of set dressing on the fly and stuff like that. All right. So, let's start this painful editing process. Yeah, it's off right there. Get that out of my way. I thought you were the director, Bassman. WTF. So the first thing I noticed is that this phrasing is really weird. I use my own system of editing notes that tend to throw people off because they're a mix of common sense stuff and just general markings, and also like random symbols from when I used to do copy editing for a newspaper. I'm gonna mark this as phrasing. Okay. So are you working the cameras then, or are you just like being a PA basically? Production assistant. Okay. Actually, you know what? You know what? I'm gonna make this easier for you guys to follow along. I'm gonna reprint that first page. I'm gonna mute my mic here.
Okay, let's try this again. I had an idea. Oh man, that's the worst. People not showing up is awful. Super unprofessional. Okay. I forgot I had all this stuff for doing this. Okay. So, let's indicate some things here. Yeah, I don't like that. Especially when you're talking a project of that caliber, that's like an actual feature film with kind of, well, not a crazy budget, like actual funding of sorts and like real things. So blue is phrasing. And I saw a flash. I hope that's not thunder. The line will be cut. Man, that would make me so angry. I do not like that stuff. This will be lookup detail and I'm gonna change that. We're doing it live. Cut, phrasing. Typo. Lookup detail. And this will be expand. That's dedication, man. That's dedication. That being said, any credit on that is going to be ridiculously great for your career. No, I feel you, bro. I do. What's up, Johnny? I'm so professional. I feel you, Johnny, I do. Do more of that stuff. Actually, I need to learn how to write query letters. That's my next thing. I want to send a couple. I have some ideas for stuff that I would like to do. Thank you. I'm only gonna mark the really obvious phrasing stuff. Obviously, we're gonna fine tune some lines and things as we go. Like, I notice I don't love this. He wished he didn't have to block his ears with wax. It's okay. I feel like it could have a little bit more punch to it. But I'm not gonna worry about that right this second. Know where the siren was at the moment. Well, A, we're gonna do our fancy, that's not supposed to be capital. I think this is an expand. Harbin decided he needed to get closer. I guess the question is where is he looking from? You're doing mock-ups? Is that what you mean? I originally thought he'd be looking down kind of like from the cliffs. So it would be like kind of this kind of scenario where, you know, it'd be like a hill and there'd be like this valley. And the house would be kind of like here with like its one side and then its other side and then a connecting side between the two. Kind of like this. Yeah, mock-ups. That's what I figured. So I figured Hypernor would kind of be here looking down. But gotta make that clearer. I should open up. Now that I'm reminded. Thanks for reminding me, Johnny. What did I do with that file? Put it in my drive, I'm pretty sure. Ah, here we go. Yeah. Okay, cool. Just pulled up my active verbs list there. So that I can take a look at that as I go. Well, if you ever do want to show me something, feel free, Baseman. No problem, I'll look it up over for you. But I understand NDAs and various other things. Casting matters, and it's not always about needing to get someone who's super professional. You just need to get someone who can represent what you want really well. Which doesn't necessarily mean a professional. I don't even have a spot to put this right now. Yeah, but I mean, sometimes that works out, right? Like, I don't know if you paid any attention to reading some behind-the-scenes stuff, but I often read all those stories about, like, hey, yeah, so the first choice for casting was George Clooney, but we got so-and-so instead. And I'm just like, you really wanted to cast George Clooney? Like, I know he's a marketable name and all, but he wouldn't have fit this role at all. Like, why would you pick him? And then it's like, well, they got some other guy instead. And it's like, well, that guy's obviously a much better choice. You know? There's lots of stories like that. Harrison Ford, I'm pretty sure, was a was not their pick, but he ended up getting it anyway for Star Wars. Because they couldn't get the other guy. Well, not quite, but, you know. Well, the odds of that happening, Johnny, are very low. I really doubt your eyeballs are gonna pop out. Yeah, this makes no sense. I mean, I know it doesn't have very much time for the contract, but why would you wait a day, like spend a day observing a location and then worry that you don't have time? Makes no sense. It's my job to be logical about this. Oh, cool, man. Oh, unless you mean the concentrating thing, in which case, yes, feel free to hyperbole all you want. Oh, I guess I can turn that down too, while I think about it. I had it up. Oh, there we go. That should be a little better. That's a good word. Cut that. We're gonna replace it with slunk. What a great word. Again, not a capital. Why not? What about a siren makes it different? There's always banter on set. There's always too much downtime, and there's always never enough people. It's just the way it is. Oh, that's too bad. It's not on my end. I've dropped literally zero frames. Literally zero. I wrote lookup detail. What I really mean there is fact check. And I'm gonna fact check this because I don't think it's gonna take him several hours to do it. I usually edit a little bit faster and looser than this, but on stream I want it to be pretty visual. So you guys can kind of see what I'm doing and follow along. A little bit better. But I could put this up here. Nice. I don't know what you call a Greek house. That's what you get for filming outside. That's hilarious. This website looks really awesome. I'm looking for, there should be more of these verbs here somewhere. Website though. I will keep that in mind for later. I can't find more. I need more. I had to move my keyboard and it's weirding me out. But whatevs. Interesting. Interesting. Yes. You shouldn't dolly track everything. It gets very noticeable when you dolly track. I think you need to mix it up. That being said, one of my favorite shots of all time is a crazy dolly track, but it's like 3.5 minutes of like a single dolly tracking, like all the way through this hotel and like stuff. It's crazy. I love it. I love Shaun of the Dead. I actually like a lot of their films. it annoys me so much, Johnny, that they're different. Like, honestly. It makes no sense. Are you going to be the main editor on it, Baseman? Excellent. Hey, Stevie, what's going on? I wanted you to know that that active verb list you sent me and the resulting website I found because of it is super useful. They have a whole bunch of really interesting things. I'm looking at a crutch words list of things to cut. Things that shouldn't be in there. Or at least take a look at. I will post it. This place is really cool. Yeah. This place is just really cool. There's a ton of really interesting stuff in here. I just been flipping through it. I was hoping because they on that active verbs list they say see different words, but those words aren't actually in this document, so it's unhelpful. But yeah, I was hoping to find more. But still, very useful. Very yeah, this should be stronger. I'm gonna use my phrasing here. This can be stronger. I think this metaphor of rotten, decaying housing, I think that image should be stronger. Yeah. And I know that I'm bad for it because I write in such a simplistic way. I feel like I actually go to those crutch words even more so than some other writers do. Like what I'm doing is, as I'm going through it, I'm just circling them. Not saying they necessarily need to be cut or whatever, but just take a look at it. See what ones you can do something better with, as we go. Really? I can see why they would say that. I'm not sure how I feel about that. That being said, I don't know. Whenever I talk about metaphors, I immediately go to Borges. I don't know if you've ever heard me talk about Borges, Stevie, but Borges is one of my personal heroes. His writing is quite literally a code. He writes in this way that everything is a metaphor or a reference or a shorthand or something to a bigger idea. And you literally, like, you can read his stories and be amazed, and then you sit down with an encyclopedia beside you or the internet, and there's whole other worlds of story within his stories. He wrote a collection called Labyrinths, and that's what it was. There was labyrinths of metaphor and reference and intertextuality within each story, which were also about labyrinths. Like, the man was a genius. Like, absolutely. Yeah. Just amazing. Just amazing. Yeah.
Jorge Luis Borges.
Is what word again? What did I just do? Oh. Yes, intertextuality. Introduction by William Gibson of Neuromancer fame. I've never read it, to be honest. I don't know. It's just people like I was going to. I'm just trying to find something really good. Something that won't be, like, ridiculously confusing. Keeping in mind, Borges is Argentinian. He wrote in Spanish, so these are all translations. That being said, they're very, there's a lot of conversations with Borges. And translators work closely with him. They're not, like, posthumous or anything like that. What do I got? I think that one's probably one of the better ones. Ah, yes, the Library of Babel. Perfect. By this art, you may contemplate the variation of the 23 letters, the anatomy of melancholy, part 2, section 2, member 4? I don't know what MEM stand for in literary things. But it goes as follows. The universe, which others call the library, is composed in an indefinite and perhaps infinite number of hexagonal galleries with vast air shafts between, surrounded by very low railings. From any of the hexagons, one can see interminably the upper and lower floors. The distribution of the galleries is invariable. 20 shelves, 5 long shelves per side, cover all the sides except 2. Their height, which is the distance from floor to ceiling, scarcely exceeds that of a normal bookcase. One of the free sides leads to a narrow hallway which opens onto another gallery, identical to the first and to all the rest. To the left and right of the hallway, there are 2 very small closets. In the first, one may sleep standing up. In the other, satisfy one's fecal necessities. Also, through here passes a spiral stairway, which sinks abysmally and soars upwards to remote distances. In the hallway, there is a mirror, which faithfully duplicates all appearances. Men usually infer from this mirror that the library is not infinite. If it really were, why this illusory duplication? I prefer to dream that its polished surfaces represent and promise the infinite. Light is provided by some spherical fruit which bear the name of lamps. There are 2 transversely placed in each hexagon. The light they emit is insufficient, incessant. Like all men of the library, I've traveled in my youth. I've wandered in search of a book, perhaps the catalog of catalogs. Now that my eye can hardly decipher what I write, I am preparing to die just a few leagues from the hexagon in which I was born. Once I am dead, there will be no lack of pious hands to throw me over the railing. My grave will be the fathomless air. My body will sink endlessly and decay and dissolve in the wind generated by the fall, which is infinite. I say that the library is unending. The idealists argue that the hexagonal rooms are a necessary form of absolute space, or, at least, of our intuition of space. They reason that a triangular or pentagonal room is inconceivable. The mystics claim that their ecstasy reveals to them a circular chamber containing a great circular book whose spine is continuous and which follows the complete circle of the walls, but their testimony is suspect. Their words obscure. The cyclical book is God. Let suffice now for me to repeat the classic dictum. The library is a sphere whose exact center is any one of its hexagons and whose circumference is inaccessible. There are 5 shelves for each of the hexagon's walls. Each shelf contains 35 books of uniform format. Each book is of 410 pages. Each page of 40 lines. Each line of some 80 letters, which are black in color. There are also letters on the spine of each book. These letters do not indicate or prefigure what the pages will say. I know that this incoherence at one time seemed mysterious. Before summarizing the solution, whose discovery in spite of its tragic projections is perhaps the capital fact in history, I wish to recall a few axioms. And it goes on from there. But a lot of the ways in which, like, I studied this in high school, and a lot of the ways in which we talked about this is that, I mean, what's the greater metaphor there? What's the library a representation of? Like, are the people in the library actual people? Are the books people? Are the rooms people? I think you can make an argument for all of it. And I just love some of that language of like how they describe how he describes the infinity of it all. Life is never ending. The universe is unfathomably large. Oh, totally. I mean, I studied English Lit for quite a few years in university. But yeah, I love Borges. And each story in that book is so different. Things about Babylon, Judas Iscariot, swordsmen, duels. Exactly, Stevie. It's super interesting that the mirror makes them think it's not infinite. The infinity is an illusion. Post this. So yeah, there's his Wikipedia page if you want to check him out. Right? But this is what Borges does. Like, there are so many correct answers to the metaphors that he's implying. Like, I was thinking about when I was reading it there, like, is the hexagon a city? Is the hexagon a culture? Is the hexagon a country? Right? Like, is there a... You know what I mean? Like, there's these interesting implications of what do these things represent? All right. I'll pull it up there, Stevie, and take a look. Ow. Thanks for the host, Fallen Clown. Appreciate that, man. I admit that I have not read nearly enough Ursula K. Le Guin. But yeah. Solo raid. I've done a few of those. It's all good. Is this the right word? I'm not sure. don't like this. I think it's necessary, but I want to cut it and rewrite it. Alright, bye, Bassman. Enjoy your film shoot. And don't hesitate to interrupt me or ask any questions. I'll happily answer anything you have. I know I look like I'm kind of in the zone, but that's fine. Feel free. Interrupt me. Converse. Ask me about things. And it doesn't have to be about writing. I'll answer other questions too. But I do love talking about writing. I'm gonna say cut this, replace with the siren. Because I feel like, I feel like you won't refer to her as she, Hyperinor, I mean, won't refer to her as she until he actually meets her. If at all possible. So like the next scene sort of thing. There's no real sense of scale of the of how big the house is. And fact check this, I think. How would he know this? I will actually, if you are in my Discord, or if you want to be, if you aren't already, or you want to be, you can use this link here. In the file share in Discord is the first draft, the PDF I'm working off of, as well as on my website. If you go to my website, which is right over there, it's also posted under the Fear the Siren Drafting Week. If you want to follow along, if you want to give me suggestions, feel free. I certainly don't mind. Get eyes on there. Tell me what I'm doing wrong. Tell me what I can improve. Tell me what I'm doing good. So I don't accidentally cut it. But yeah, feel free. I don't use my Discord nearly enough. I should use it more. Hmm? You can be as part of as many Discords as you want, Fallen. I think I'm in 10. I'm in 9. I'm in 9 Discords. I use probably 2 of them fairly often, and then others not as much. Welcome back, Stevie. Welcome back. I just posted a link to my Discord. I think you're already in it. There's the PDF there that I'm working off of if you wanted to take a look. It's also available on the website. Yeah, exactly. And 2 of them are yours, right? Two of them are yours, yeah. That's what I thought. This decision kind of confuses me. I think it should be expanded. Yeah, no problem, man. Thanks for stopping by. I appreciate that. I use the words toward way too often. I really like this line though. Inside, Hyperinor found horror. 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 Gorillapod, I can do weird things. This thing is awesome. One of the best gear investments I've made. I think that I need to make this more interesting. I want this to be more demonic. I want it to resonate with kind of the Faustian ideas that we've been playing around with. Less big creature. I like this word choice.
There's definitely something wrong with this place.
I use something or someone or variants on that way too often as well. So, I like this idea. But I think I need to get a better handle on the spatial relationships here. I've been hanging out with artists too much. Kappa. Because when we're in the courtyard, the house is kind of like this. Yeah, I've been hanging out with artists too much. Now I want to know how everything fits. It's this kind of style, and there's like these balconies go all the way around. This is probably not going to be a clear drawing at all for anyone except me. And there's like a stairway going up. So I guess, where was the siren? Yeah. Where was the siren hiding? And why does she attack then? Oh, actually, that's super useful. Everything is about Minecraft. Literally everything. Okay, so I'll show you guys what I'm looking at. So this is kind of what this is one way I've seen it depicted, and that floor plan certainly intrigues me. I was looking at more. I suppose that's kind of the same thing, isn't it? That's a bigger version of the same photo. This is a real life one. But I've seen a lot of depictions like this, and this was kind of the way I was going for it. Though when I look at this, this is probably a much more expensive house. In terms of style. Like rich versus poor, I guess. That being said, it is supposed to be a rich man's house. So I was going for kind of something like this. But I guess the stairs are still inside. Interesting, I hadn't thought about that. That being said, I don't know why the siren would pick a fight inside. It would make much more sense for her to pull the action outside, where she could use her wings. Interesting. Yeah. I'll have to think about it more, but I will make the notes. I suppose this is actually wrong. It's just really more this part. Maybe jaw is a better word there. Oh, I realize this should. I want this to be opposite. I want him to hear it, not feel it. Maybe add a little bit more detail. Action scenes are incredibly difficult to describe. Like, it's something that I could do, like, if I was writing a comic, I could totally do. I can write action scenes for comics. I can't, it's so much harder. It's so much harder in prose. Detail. It's because it's difficult to describe using words complex movements without it sounding awful. Here's kind of what I mean, Ronnie.
Yeah, we're gonna do action demos. So say you're like doing an action scene and your character like throws a right and then ducks a left and throws another right. How do you describe that without saying like he throws a left, then he ducks, then he throws a right? Like how do you make that moment intense? How do you give up drama? Is your sentence going to be super long? Is it going to be hard to read because it's long? Like, there's... Yeah, and exactly what you're saying, Stevie. Like, it ends up sounding kind of like a recipe. Like, a right fist is thrown, then a left fist is thrown, then he ducks. Like, you got... And then that's a simple movement compared to, like, things like, what if he throws, like, a spinning back kick? And then he ducks down and then uppercuts with a knee or something. Like, it gets a lot more complicated. And then you gotta make sure that your reader knows who's doing what action and when within that complex series of movements. And the way that I did it, like, I'm describing a single character. What if the other character is doing something in reaction? And you wanna describe that as well so that you know. You know, like in my example where I have ducks and stuff, like what is he ducking? How is he ducking? Are you indicating why? Things. Things I didn't think I was going to do today. Demonstrate martial arts poorly. Yeah, and then not to mention, I have a character who flies. Who quite literally flies. So, you know, it just makes things even weirder. I don't think it can't be done. I just don't think I'm very good at it. Action sequences that aren't fight scenes that involve less characters and less movements, I can do those fairly well. Did I look more ridiculous yesterday? Oh, you're talking about when I was playing Divive. Yes, I probably looked way more ridiculous yesterday. I don't like the way this is described. The siren was a lot bigger than he expected. I feel like there's a better way to put that. Maybe I'm crazy. Hey, question, what's up, man? So here's a weird thing that maybe you know better than I do, Stevie, but I'm from Canada, right? And we use the metric system. But everyone describes things in terms of feet and not meters. Like, we'll use kilometers, but we won't use meters. Like, height. Definitely don't measure that in centimeters, like a lot of places do. And it's super weird, because, like, I kind of want to describe this in meters, but it makes more sense to me in feet. I don't know. I'm probably just being weird about it.
right? Like, if I talk about the size of my room, I know that my room is, I know that my room is 16 feet wide, but I have no idea how many meters it is. But I know how many kilometers I know from downtown, or how many kilometers it is to work. Well, see, that's interesting. That's actually an interesting point, because ancient Greece didn't use either of those. So I should probably measure it in something like paces. I'm gonna fact check that. 15 feet. Greek units of measure. Yeah, no, that totally makes sense. I hadn't even considered that, but I mean, yeah. That being said way too much. I use the currency of drachmas, but I didn't think of the feet thing. I should measure in cubits. That's what I should do. Cubit being the middle tip to the elbow. That's a cubit, which is, you know, like, I think a foot and a half. I'm horrible at estimation. This lists ancient Greek had a cubit called a peches. Ivory tile wall. Oh man, see, I'm breaking every habit I have for writing to do this style of editing. This is not how I do things. And that's not how I draft, like, what I've been doing this week. I'm just trying to be a little bit clearer and less, like, crazy with the way that I do it. Because no one will understand the way that I do it. Yeah. That makes sense. Measure it in, like, pillars. Nice, Johnny. So, 18 inches. Oh, God. Math. Yeah. I don't know if you ever, if you've heard me talk about it, but I do a lot of iterations where I'll expand, like I'll write in, I'll write kind of like a movie script where I'll write I'll write like a bunch of sentences as like, this paragraph is going to be about this. And then I'll make that like two sentences and then four sentences and like build it out. And I do a lot of iterations. Like dinner has almost 20 drafts at this point. Dinner being one of the short stories I'm working on, like outside of the stream. Like 20 iterations or something. Uh, 15 feet. Oh my God. So 15 feet is approximately 18 inches, which means that this is approximately 10 pitches. There we go. We learned something about Greek things. Yeah, I agree with you, Stevie. Showing, not telling. I tend to be fairly good at that, but it's weird, right? I know, but there's none that makes sense. I mean, I suppose I could just call it a qubit and hope that people don't murder me for being unclear. I could do paces, I guess. Paces is about 5 feet, so probably 3 paces. 4 paces, maybe. 3.5. No, but qubits are used a lot in, like, Roman stories and different things. So I feel like at least qubits people would kind of get. Whatever. I wrote them both. I'll make a decision later. I'm not doing it now. Expand on this. Make this image better. Make it clearer. Not sure this makes sense. Intentionally makes it wide as a string. Seems a little too like. Seems a little out of character. I can do that. That's not a problem. I know, but it's because of the 90 degree angle, I can't get exactly all of it in focus. I can definitely turn off the autofocus, that's not a problem. And that probably would help with some of that. I wish I had a little bit more overhead light as well. To get, like, less dark on this side. But alas, I moved everything when I was setting up my Vive, and my lights are all in the wrong spots, and I forgot to reset them this morning. I almost forgot to turn them on. Period. So, you know. Repetition with the word swing. And I want to look up ways to describe mechanical arms without them sounding like they're from science fiction. I think maybe metallic might be a better word here. Because would Hyperinor know it's mechanical? Who knows? I don't know. VR is amazing. VR is amazing. I mean, it's got kinks. It's definitely got kinks. The primary one being the cost of entry, of course. But think with the way it's going, it's a game changer for sure. I want to see more games that I want to see more games that are closer to what we see from AAA titles now, that aren't so aren't as gimmicky. That being said, VR games right now are not pricey. There's not a ton of games. There's not very many games at all that are like more than $10. Because of that, because they tend to be very like, we do this one thing, we do it really well, and this is the only thing you do in it. Like, there's lots of like skeet shooting and bow and arrow games and stuff like that. So, you know, I think that's changing. I think there's games in development. I just bought a co-op robot FPS that I'm going to be playing with my friend Sam in the next couple of days, which should be awesome. But yeah, it's interesting. There's a lot of experiments, a lot of experimental stuff going on right now. It's going to take a little bit of time to get... Yeah, the process was long. I redid it this morning, Johnny, and it took me one try. I moved around a couple cameras so that it'd be better. It took me one try to do it. I definitely think if you're going to get VR, you should have space for it. Like my office is the minimum the minimum room scale distance. I would recommend having more. Having the extra space really helps with your immersion. It really allows you to explore a little bit more, and not punch walls and stuff. I definitely punch my wall at least twice. See, and this is what I was talking about, action. Hyperinor stepped back, deflecting the strike with his blade. It's like, this step here is not dramatic enough for an action sequence. And it doesn't really mesh well with his movement of deflecting the blade. Or deflecting the... strike, blow, punch. I don't know. And then this seems out of sequence. Like, there needs to be something in between here. I don't like the use of the word creature here. There's this little bit of arrogance that I'm not sure about. Because he's kind of an arrogant character. We see that when I wrote the scene about him meeting Darius, the fat rich guy, in the stable, where you know he kind of puts the fear of God into him just for funsies. And this comes across as a different type of arrogance. So like I feel like this could be flavored better. Sirens were one of the more dangerous creatures in the land. Sounds like a Animal Planet narrator. This stuff's good, but it needs to move up. I'm gonna do one of these guys. Move this section to the beginning when you first mention the earwax. And I think this is a phrasing thing here. I think I meant combined here. Does dragon's blood actually protect him from? Probably not something I'm going to mention in the story. I'm just curious for my own sake. So I have kind of an idea of where his powers lie. Okay, yeah, and then if I'm cutting most of this paragraph, I can move this other paragraph here, move down one paragraph. and have the detail of the siren singing inside this one here where she's flying overhead and Hyperion's kind of watching her. Makes way more sense. Sure about that. So I'm gonna add a question mark there. And then this seems oddly repetitive. Of that section there. Too quickly, calm, beauty, slow. I like this style that I'm doing in this story though. Where I've kind of got this weird, like, thought thing going on. I do it a couple times. At the end of the story, when he's getting knocked unconscious, I do something similar. I like it. Just wing will be fine here. The meaty part. Huh. I think this needs to be rephrased. She tried to take off again, but the pain kept her down. I think it's real close. I don't like the use of the word down there. It seems a little casual. Not quite what I'm going for. And again, I think this is the wrong flavor of arrogance. I'm not really, like, I think I'm going to keep the idea of him being arrogant in there, but I want it to be a different type of arrogance. I guess what I mean by that is these come across as very, like, these come across as, like, look at my skills. And I want him to be more like, fear me, arrogant. If that makes sense. Because that's kind of the flavor that I liked when I did it in, like, you don't mess with me, arrogant. Fear me, arrogant. Rather than, look at my skills, arrogant. I don't like this. I don't like this at all, actually. I think it should be the opposite way around. He's closing in on his prey. Not... swung. I originally liked this word, use of the word rebuild here, but again, I don't know if Hypernor would know about it or what he think about it. I'm trying to think of, like, the reason I hesitate to call it a mechanical arm is because we're writing from Hypernor's point of view, and there really shouldn't be any details that he doesn't know about inserted in here. Like, so if he doesn't know it's a mechanical arm, or he doesn't know that it was rebuilt, or he really doesn't know anything about it except it's metal. So putting in those details gives the reader more information, yes, but information that our characters wouldn't know, or that this character wouldn't know. So it feels disingenuous. At least to me it does. So I don't love this either. I'm probably gonna cut this. I wanna replace this with it took Hypernor by surprise. Like more of a sequence where Hypernor advances. I'm gonna use a different word when I write it. But the siren pushes back. So here, gotta add detail. I want the song to kind of burst into his head. And in relation to that, there should be another detail somewhere that indicates she's still singing. Now, I'm not 100% sure how I want to do the siren song. I don't hate this. It's okay. I wonder if it'd be better just to use musical notes, like not indicating the content of the song, what the lyrics are or whatever. I also wonder if maybe the song should more be about her story. What is she actually singing about? Is the context of the song different per the listener? Because the only thing we know about, or the only thing that's always represented by the Siren Song, is A, that's a song. B, it's intensely attractive. It can seduce men. They say seduce men. I honestly assume it can seduce any human. Period. But you know, ancient Roman prejudice and all that. Ancient Roman, ancient Greek as well, though less so. But yes. And that it's been described several times by several different writers as being as sweet as it is sad. So it is both alluring and beautiful, but at the same time it's sad, but it's not like depressing. It's a beautiful sad, like a hopeful sadness, something like that. So yeah, I need to decide how I'm going to represent the content of that song. I'm okay with this because it's kind of communicating her underlying idea of what she's trying to do to Hypernor with the song, but it feels a little on the nose. I want it to be a little more abstracted, I think. Adjust the phrasing on this. I don't like using closer and closer. I would like it to be a little less like the horror movie and a little bit more like a little less horror movie, because it is horrifying, but in the end he kind of wants it because of the song. Like, I gotta figure out, like, what's the effect her powers are having? What is she doing to him? I think I have a solid idea of what that is, but yeah. Well, it is critique, Johnny, but at the same time, like, I'm trying to, part of the editing process, or at least the way that I've kind of felt about the editing process, is that there should be no uninformed decisions. There should be no arbitrary decisions. You have power as a writer, as an author. You have power. And with that power comes great responsibility in a certain way. It's okay to not have an answer in your first couple of drafts. But as you get into it, you should have an answer. You should know why a certain thing happens and how it happens and what's the flavor and why you've chosen to do it in that way. And I think in a lot of ways, that's what distinguishes good writing from bad writing. When we talk about, like, the great American novel, like The Great Gatsby, or if we talk about Borges, there are no uninformed decisions. There are no uninformed word choices. And I'm not the greatest at this yet. It's something that I'm trying to improve. Stevie has been helping me a lot with that. With working on, you know, my word choices. I'm working on, you know, yeah, write in a readable manner. But write in a readable manner that's interesting. How does your character choices and the things that you say and describe indicate the theme of the story, characterization. Exactly, Johnny. I think in a lot of ways it's the same thing. How you choose to represent your form's volume, how you choose to light certain things. They'll make a difference on how beautiful it is or how different it looks, but at the same time, they should have meaning. You're not going to have light sources from every direction. You're not going to have the same representations of something that's close to you that's far away. You know, there's decisions that you are making, and some of them are unconscious. I think art more so than writing, there's a lot more unconscious decisions, because of the visual medium of it. That being said, I think there's a lot of subconscious decisions in writing as well. But I guess what I'm trying to say with all of this is that you really want to take those subconscious decisions and analyze why you've made that decision. And it's okay not to know, but you want to explore that. See if there's maybe a way you can make it better. Or see if maybe there is something later on that you can reference back to that and it make the piece more informed and better. Like little characterization elements, descriptors, the way that you describe things. So for the first time in a while, because I've actually written like basically the story, like the entirety of it, I can actually sit down and say, well, you know, in this later scene, I wrote it this way. So I really should reflect that kind of that way that character acts throughout the entirety of the piece. And that's what I'm talking about with like the arrogance. It's like, I really like that aspect of his arrogance. Arrogance is a human character trait. I'm arrogant. Other people are arrogant. Like there's arrogance and it makes him a little bit unlikable, but at the same time, it's also what makes him a little bit likable. Because we're like, oh, there's like this kind of rich douchey guy, and he's playing him a little, he's playing some pranks on him, and that's why I think this flavor is wrong. It's kind of like this skills arrogance, and I don't like it. I want that sort of playful fear me arrogance, of like, you know, this is who I am. I'm a monster. Be scared of me. I'm going to write that down because that was good. I spelled it horribly wrong. Characterization. There you go. Or right, Paranar. Look at me. I'm a monster. Fear me. And the reason that sort of flavor of him using his monstrosity as a fear tactic is because it's the part that he most hates about himself that he uses as his most effective tool. I was listening to you, Stevie. I was. So yeah, these are the things that I'm trying to think through, that I'm trying to indicate in this editing process of where can I add more of that element? Where can I make that element matter? Stuff like that, like details like the distance. You know, I've described it in feet, but that doesn't really reflect who my characters are. They should describe it how they would think of it. That's cool with drawing. Go ahead. Exercise your butt off. Do your thing. Thanks for hanging out. Man, we're 2 hours in. 2 hours in, and I'm on page 4 of 18. That being said, I think this is, like, really good editing. Like, I'm really happy with the way that this is going. It's about nuance. Like, the text is okay, and there are elements of the text that I want to change, but there's all these really cool nuances that I'm trying to massage into it. Yeah, so, like, I like this. Like, her smile was seductive, and it gave Hypernor all the wrong kinds of shivers. She's a monster, too. Don't like this. What are Hypernor's thoughts during this whole... Hypernor's thoughts while he's frozen. Song was so sweet and so sad. Rather than telling this, show us Hypernor's emotions. Why do I always try and write his name with a lowercase h? How Hypernor's emotions are affected. The thing about him finding, him realizing that he's crying. Affected. There we go. Like, him realizing that he's crying is a good image for that. Like, he's not sad, but he's crying. He's not happy, but he's not sad. He's not smiling. Like, there are some images there that I think are really effective. From all the sensations, yes, we do use all a lot, and it is very unspecific, and unspecific words are not nice. I don't dislike this, I actually kind of like this, but I almost want it to mirror how I did that weird, like, him breathing hard thing on page 3. Or page 2? No, page 3, I think. Oh, it was on page 4. Where I want it to be kind of weird, conflicting, like singular thoughts. I think this is a phrasing issue. Actually, I think this is an expand. I want to expand on this. Because I haven't reminded people in a while, feel free to ask questions. I know I'm in my zone, doing my thing, but feel free to interrupt, ask questions. I'm open. Talk about things. I want to have conversations. I want to know what I can do better. I want to know what you think are things I'm doing effectively. About the stream, about writing, about whatever, you know. Yeah. Feel free to ask, interrupt. I'm happy to answer your questions. I don't like this. For a guy who spends a day watching an empty house, he's awfully casual about this. Random question. What do sirens eat? Just out of general curiosity. What do sirens eat? Do a quick adjustment there. So maybe I can get this a little bit different of a focus. Yeah, let's try that. That looks a little bit better. Maybe not. Yeah, that's better. Huh. Who is his contacts? How do they keep in touch? I don't need the answer to that. I don't need to include the answer to those in the story. I just kind of want to get a better feel for how does he get his contracts? Who gives them to him? You know, is he easy to track down? Does he have a special broker? You know, give the story a little bit more context in terms of the way that this world works. Yeah. I mean, obviously the King's Stables, but Perrinor had arrived early to inspect the area. Phrasing. And this is another thing, with the way that I'm kind of portraying this character, is that he's fairly careful. He plans ahead. He waits. He waits for the right moment. He studies the area. So that sort of like my skills are better than others arrogance doesn't really work. It's through his careful planning, his skills, and his experience, like those three things are what kind of make him monstrous. Because not only is he an actual monster, like by blood, but he's monstrous in terms of being an assassin. Like there's elements that build into that. I think this is meetings, not contracts. I like this casual. Always some hero looking to make a name for himself by slaying some monsters. There's a phrasing thing here. Actually, I think I could just cut that line entirely. I don't think it's necessary. I think that's very implied by the next line, and we also kind of know that he's not human from the previous scene. So I think that can just be cut. Hero looking. To make a name for himself by slaying a few monsters. Perrinor watched the sunset. It's going to be a cool night. Wasn't the first time in this story he was thankful. I don't hate that, but I think the phrasing out of it is wrong. I also think it's Hey, Erica, what's going on? I'm doing good. I'm editing through the story I wrote this week. I'm like almost 2.5 hours in. I've gotten like 5 pages. This is a long process. Actually, this is a very good editing process. Because I actually drafted basically the entire story this week. What the hell's up with my hair? I have context for decisions, and having context for decisions is super cool. Where I can flavor things. I can spice things up. I can do different things to them things again. I've been talking about this a lot, but I'm not a draft at all and edit kind of guy. I'm a small iterations, constant adaptation and editing stylistically. I feel like because of how successful this editing process has been for me, and I specifically tried to do it this way on stream so as to not confuse people as much as possible, that I want to adapt elements of it into my own work, into the way that I write in general. So I feel really good about this editing process versus my usual editing process, which is just like, expand on this, expand on this, expand on this, expand on this. But yeah, it's something I'm going to think about. I don't think this reflects... I don't think this reflects his perspective on his monstrous blood. I said earlier that I think in a lot of ways he hates being a monster, but at the same time has resigned himself to it. Yeah, I don't do it all the time, but I really wanted something visual on stream, and I've done this before, and I think it works. Just to give people kind of a better idea when they look at the general page, like what is changing? What am I trying to change? How am I trying to change it? Yeah. Yeah. So on the one hand, like, I wonder if I could almost play... I wonder if I could kind of play it where he's thankful in this instance, but it's kind of like a, like, I would rather be cold, but I'm glad I'm not cold, but at the same time I would still kind of rather be cold. I don't know, something like that. Like, that's what I'm feeling. Yeah, I saw you talking about, or maybe you mentioned it last time I tuned in. But there, yeah, I saw you talking about that, and that's kind of the thing, is I'm trying to speed it up a little bit. I'm going to be trying to do more writing experiments. For sure. Like, I want to do more writing experiments, more studies. This is something... I spend a lot of time with art streamers. And I know you watch TV and all that, so you watch at least some art streamers in general. But they do studies. They do, like, little self-contained bits in order to become better at a specific thing. And I wonder, like, I honestly wonder why writers don't do that. Why we don't, like, sit down and say, like, well, I'm going to work on dialogue today. So I'm going to write dialogue. And I'm going to make it better. And I'm going to figure out what I'm doing wrong. and what I want to do and stuff like that. Like, why are we not doing more of those types of things to improve our skills? And the answer that, like, I first came up with, was like, well, you know, why do that when you can just write a story and do all those things? It's like, sure, I get that. But does that really help you improve? Or are you just going to have a bunch of mediocrity for the entire thing? Like, I don't know. But yeah, I agree with you. I want to do, I've been thinking about doing some more short fiction. So like 100 word drabbles and like some of that kind of style stuff on stream where I could like really push word choice or really push certain things or write a few of them over a course of a stream and play with it. Yeah, exactly. Like grammar, I don't have the time to write a short story a week, for sure. But, but yeah, that kind of style of doing that stuff. I like the image thing. I've been thinking of various exercises based on similar ideas. Like I was thinking of doing an exercise where. If I looked at a series of movie titles and movie posters, and wrote a story with all of them, like if there was 15 or something like that, 15 to 20, and wrote a story that used all of them. Like something like that, like something to like really push you outside. Not really a believer in half measures. Oh yeah, that sounds super interesting. Like, do it in past tense and then rewrite it in totally different grammatical sense. I really like that. I think that's a great idea. Like, how does it change when you change? Like, how does the feeling of it change? I'm very intrigued. I would like to see the results of that. Yeah. I'm complex. I'm complex in my thought process. I get that. but I was also thinking of I did a music exercise a while back. I did an exercise I also did in a playwriting class from back when I was in college. And that's what I did was I did two exercises in one day where I did the music exercise and I did the dialogue lines exercise, and I made them the same story from two different characters' perspectives. Because it just kind of all went in. And the part that I really liked about doing that dialogue exercise was that people in the chat were like, oh, well, when you organize it like that, it makes total sense. It's like, yeah, you have to think about it in terms of what kind of narrative you're telling. Okay, cool. What do you mean by multi POV? Like switching POVs, or like, see, now I'm kind of curious as to what a multi POV story means. Like, what if you were telling the story, with like each paragraph being from a different perspective, or, like. Yeah, like each character, like each paragraph would be from a different perspective, or writing multiple perspectives into the same piece. So it'd be like a third person limited, but it'd be third person limited multi. I don't know. I have weird thoughts when it comes to that stuff. I really want to write a story that is that can be told both beginning to end and end to beginning and tell two different stories. Yeah, and I honestly, I kind of assume it would fail. But I want to know what I would learn from doing it. Like, that's kind of the thing that I want to do more on stream, is do that kind of style stuff where, like, I try things and I expect them to fail, but I want to see what happens. Interesting. I want to do more narrative. I know you're really into RPGs, Gordwin. But I want to do more RPG narrative experiments. Not just like playing RPGs, but like how do you use like an RPG character creation system in order to drive your writing? Or how do you use a specific mechanic to drive actual narrative writing? And stuff like that. And not just RPGs, games in general. Images, art processes. Like, I'm super intrigued by that stuff. I would argue you don't even need to do entire stories, Erica. You could do vignettes. Like, you could do, like, a series of, like, one or two paragraph vignettes to describe all their character traits. Okay, cool, Ward. Like, the RPG thing? Like working RPG element or using RPGs to help develop your narrative skills. Yeah, I mean, this is one of the things I really like about Twitch. Having that ability to ask questions and get an immediate or semi-immediate response. And using that to push your own stuff forward. Theme development. I'm intrigued. I am actually struggling a little bit with theme development on one of my other stories. So if you had some like bite-sized tidbits for me at the moment, I would love that. I got my VR set in. So... I was kind of lost in the VR world last night. Yeah, I'm excited for your Scrivener thing. Stevie sent me an interesting article on Twitter a couple days ago about an art, like, it was from 2009, I think. It was like from 4 or 5 years ago when she first bought Scrivener or was looking at it. And it was really interesting. It was kind of saying a lot of the same stuff that I was saying to you when you were struggling with your word processor, with your Microsoft Word. I hate Microsoft Word, by the way. I haven't used it in probably since grade 12, so almost 8, 9 years ago, 7 years ago, something like that. It's not that hard. I mean, it's a word processor is still a word processor. It's the other cool stuff that it gives you that really make it worthwhile. Yeah, I do. I have it open on my other window here, actually. I wrote this entire story in Scrivener. So yeah. Uh, So the thing that, well, the reason I like Scrivener is because I can have multiple documents in the same document, so I don't have to worry about all those, like I can write scenes and chapters individually and not have to worry about them being in separate documents. It's much cleaner for that. And B, I love the compiling aspects. I love that I can write a comic book without having to label panel numbers or page numbers. It'll automatically do that for me. Same with compiling all of the stuff together when you write like a story or something. And you can just select a different drop down, like there's like a drop down, and you can just be like, oh, compile it in a totally different format without having to format the entire document. Like there's a lot of really cool things with that I like. So it's not very hard though. There's plenty of stuff in there that I don't even use. Like the metadata stuff, I don't use nearly enough of that. Like the way that you can link binders and different things, like don't even play with that. Like I do. Yeah, exactly. Like that's exactly what I'm saying, Word. Like you can compile it into different styles, and it's way easier to use than the style menu in Word, trust me. It's not that different. The only thing there's a few things I dislike, but the only thing I really hate about it is I hate the way that it does tables. I hate its tables so much. Like they're so useless. Yeah, that was me. You're teaching me. I don't hate this, but I don't think it reflects his character. The tutorial is huge. Yeah. I just run into issues with tables all the time. So I try my best not to use them. It's not good for that kind of stuff. And also the lack of image support. I don't like that either. But yeah. I mean, as far as just like writing a novel, yes. It's one of the best tools for sure. Comics as well. I think it's the best scripting program for comics, bar none. And I've used Final Draft, I've used Celtex, I've used a bunch of different things to write comics. It's definitely the best. That being said, I don't love their screenwriting elements. I would prefer to use a dedicated screenwriting software, and I do. I don't know who Katarina is. I assume she's a writing streamer? Or just another writer? Someone random? You're saying that like I should know her.
Yeah, I guess, I mean, this is really all kind of the same thing. I don't hate it, but it, I don't think it 100%, I think it has the wrong flavor of arrogance. Like, again, it has to do with that weird skills. I want it to be more reflective of, want to be more reflective of that sort of, like, hating himself, I'm a monster, fear me, arrogance, and not the sort of weird skills, he's a dunce arrogance. Okay, cool. I don't like Scrivener for writing screenplays. That being said, my hesitance with using Scrivener for screenplays could just be because I've spent so much time in actual screenwriting software. Like, we had to own Final Draft for my college program. So I used Final Draft, and I've used a little bit of Celtex, and I've used, like, a bunch of other ones. So I've actually used a lot of screenwriting softwares, and Scrivener is just not nearly as quick for me. I can jump into... Trelby's the newest one I found. I was using it to update some stuff this summer for my portfolio. But yeah. In one of those, I can just write. Like, I don't have to think about it. In Scrivener, the process is much broader. So it's harder for me. But like I said, like, even though those dedicated script writing software stuff, like, it does not work, are not nearly as good for comics as Scrivener is. Because of Scrivener's good, like, the way that it handles layouts, the way that it handles compiling and all that stuff, it makes comics much, much easier. Because of those, and it's because they included the script writing stuff that it allows it to do that. But yeah. Yeah, question. For what, man? You're talking about just, like, general writing, you're talking about screenwriting, like, I can give you lots of places to look. Free stuff for comics and or short stories. If you're looking for just general word processor, I recommend LibreOffice. It's a free open source branch of OpenOffice that I like a little bit better. It handles things better, in my opinion. If you're looking for more screenwriting software, Trelby is really good. And if you want kind of another one, Celtex. Celtex is pretty good for doing scripts and comics and that kind of thing. Yeah, for sure. I don't know if there's one that is really good at doing both comics and prose, other than Scrivener, but Scrivener's not free. That being said, it's not very expensive either. But yeah. I don't really know. Yeah. That's all I got. I don't think Trelby is very good for writing comics. It's probably one of the worst ones I've ever used for writing comics, but it's very good at writing screenplays. So yeah, I literally only use it for screenplays, though. Because I write comics in Scrivener. Yeah, man. No problem. Yeah, you showed that to me last time. It looks okay. I think in terms of multi-collaboration, I think Celtex does better. But, I don't know. That being said, like, screenwriting software is screenwriting software. It really, isn't that different. I mean, Final Draft has a few things that other ones don't have, but is it worth the $200? Probably not. I do often write a lot by hand. I didn't write any of this by hand, because I did all on stream. But I do write a lot by hand. I find the actual the act of writing jogs my muscles better. It depends. It depends what mood I'm in. I do a lot of editing by hand, like a ton. I almost always edit by hand. And a lot of what I'll do is I'll write at my computer, and then I work a full-time job. So like I'll go to work, and on the bus or like during my breaks, I'll edit, and I'll write phrases, paragraphs, have extra things in there. So like, yeah. Well, yeah, I'm a big gamer, so I don't have any Linux PCs, despite the fact that I actually really like Linux. Actually, I was thinking about putting Linux on my old laptop to see if it would run better. But, you know. Actually, I'm not sure how I feel about this. The comedy element here at all. Yeah, I use Google Docs on Android. I store all of my Scrivener stuff and all my writing projects in my Drive, because I have a professional Drive account that uses my domain and all that for my email and stuff. Yeah. Totally worth it. Actually, that reminds me, I need to switch some of that stuff over. This I'm fine with. Woo! Finished 5 pages of 18. See if I have 15 minutes. Let's see if I can finish this 6th page and be like, yeah, I finished a third. Yeah. I always want to spell it. Okay. Cool. Yeah. Oh. Hitting buttons. Okay, cool. Yeah, man. I love having an email with my domain. It makes so much sense. It makes things easier. And then yeah, I like the pro Google Docs stuff. They give you a lot of things. It's neat. Hyperonor of the Spartoi. Fact checking. You have come to hire my sword, have you not?
So I love this. I actually really like this. I love how sword and sorcery and ridiculous this is. But this line of dialogue, this line, does not reflect any of the other dialogue in this story. But it's so different. Change this or the rest. I'm leaning towards the rest at this point. I really like it. Yeah, man. That makes sense. Yeah, and as a professional writer or artist or whatever, you should have your own website. You totally should. It's such a worthwhile investment in this day and age. All right, word. Take care, man. Expand on this. Yes, that will be me. I'm terrible at voices, by the way. Technically anything with dot anything is a link. Technically speaking. But yeah. Fair enough. You should. I always write it like this. It's like so it doesn't set things off and gives people the idea. I don't like this grin. Also, grin is one of the words on the things to keep out, watch out for, because you're an amateur. Me being an amateur. You know. Again, capture that arrogance flavor. Itchy nose. I don't think this is necessary. Probably just sheath blade. He was fat and balding, a rich man by his look. A lordling, perhaps, but most likely a merchant. His clothes were shabbier than Hyperinar would have expected. Blah. I like that. I like that fine stuff. I think there's a little bit of a transition issue, though. Feel like there can be a little bit more flow. Add more flow. Yeah, I tried to get brendanrowe.com and I couldn't because it's owned by some lawyer who has a website from 1998.
gmail.com. That being said, my name isn't super common. Oh, hey. It's empty now. Well, sort of. It has a parked thing on it. Interesting. So either the guy is redoing his website or it's gone to somebody else. Yeah, see, I don't like this. I don't like this line. And I think this curiosity should come out more. The term add tags, that's what I'm putting there. Anyway, I want to add more like he said she said sort of things, make it clear who's speaking in general. I don't hate this dialogue, but I'm not sure how effective it is. Take a look at this dialogue. Snappier. And make him less terse. Okay, so it's currently always Johnny, always, please, you know me. So yeah, it is 2:57, so I have 3 minutes left. I finished 6 pages of editing, so I'm about a third of the way through. So yeah, I'm going to keep working on this on stream tomorrow on my regular show, which will be at 7 p.m. Eastern. I know you're streaming somewhere around there, Erica, but yeah, we'll be 7 p.m. Eastern, standard time. Yeah. It kind of does, though. If you use, where was it? Okay. But you usually stream on Sundays, right? So tomorrow is my regular show, 7 p.m. Eastern. I'm going to be keeping working on this. And I believe my friend Sam is going to come and interview me. So that should be fun. Yeah, see, I told you, 7 p.m. Eastern. Oh my god. Phone. One second. Okay, we're good. Yeah. So my friend Sam's gonna come interview me, I think. I'm gonna confirm that tonight.
And yeah,
I'll keep working on this, get it done, hopefully. But yeah, what I was saying was, if you go to, where was it? Yeah, if you go to the comments and footnotes, you can insert, where is it? That thing where you can't find the thing that you're actually looking for right when you need it. Tools, writing tools, no. Oh yeah, here. So if you insert comments, you can select things to insert comments and put them in. Hey, this is pretty good. You can do annotations, but comments works as well. And you can print them, like it'll print the comments in line if you set it up right, which is awesome. So see, like, I should probably go to my main screen here. I was totally doing that on screen and totally messed up. it's hard to read because it's so small right there, but you can see that it actually shows the comments when you highlight them and all that. Right, but you can print them. You mean like Google Docs style, I'm assuming. Yeah. Meh. I agree. I think there's some stuff that Scrivener could add. I feel like they're working on a new version. Because they haven't updated anything in a while. So I'm hoping they have a new version in the works, which would be awesome. Yeah. So, other than that, I think that's it for me for today. My name is Brendan. This has been Accidental Origin, your weekly writing web show, appearing daily for this week only. Thanks for hanging out with me, guys and gals. I really enjoyed today's conversations about exercises, and I got some really good editing done. I'm happy with the choices I've made in terms of writing this particular story. So yeah, other than that, lugs and hugs. I'm out. Peace. John Derek Murphy, 2016. I don't know. Peace out, y'all. Post stream. There we go. Oh, and I totally didn't take a break at all. Look at that.